Google launched the Credential Manager last November, a new way to securely sign your users into your Android applications. With this update, they also announced that they will deprecate the one-tap login, the previously recommended way of implementing Google sign-in in your Android app. In this video, we'll walk through how to implement a Google sign-in using the new Credential Manager, as well as connect it to Supabase Authentication so that you can make a secure API request to your backend. Let's dive in. Let's first create an empty application. You can rename it if you want to, but I'm just going to leave it as default. Hit finish and let's wait for a bit until the project is ready. Okay, so we are back. Let me make some adjustments and make the font a bit bigger. Let's start up by adding the dependencies. Open the app-level-build.gradle.kts file and scroll all the way down. Throughout this tutorial, I'll be referring to this official sign-in your user with Credential Manager guide. Down here, we can find the first dependency. Let's copy it and paste it over. We should also make an edit to our ProGuard file. Copy this and paste it into our ProGuard rules.pro file. Now we are heading over to the Google sign-in specific docs, and towards the top we can find the dependency that we need to install. Copy this line and paste it into our dependencies. Let's adjust the format. And we can go back and find the latest version. For me, that is 1.1.0, but for you, it might be something different. Paste it in there and we're good. Let's sync the project with the Gradle files. Now we can get started with implementing the Google sign-in button. Let's create a new composable function. Call it Google sign-in button. It'll have a button and a text that says sign in with Google. And then we'll be implementing the sign-in logic. Now let's create the onClick method up here. Pass the onClick right here. First, we get a reference to our Credential Manager by calling credentialManager.create. We can get the context outside of the onClick method by calling localContext.current. Then we create a getGoogleID option instance. This will contain a bunch of options we will pass to the Credential Managers later. Call getGoogleIdOption.builder. Let's import it. Then chain set filter by authorized accounts and pass false. Then also chain set server client ID. We can pass an empty string for now. And lastly, call set nonce and wrap it up with the build. Now let's fill up the client ID here. Head over to Google Cloud Dashboard. You can create a Google account for free if you don't have one yet. Search for APIs and services. And open credentials. Here, we'll be creating two OAuth client IDs. Click Create Credentials and choose OAuth client ID. Select Android as the application type. We can get the package name from our application. Let's paste it in there. For SHA-1 certificate fingerprint, you can click the link that says Learn More to learn how you can obtain one. For me, I got mine right here. And we can hit Create. Now, we actually don't need this client ID. Let's move on to creating our second OAuth client ID. This time pick web application. We can actually just leave everything as default and hit create. And this client ID is the client ID that we want to paste over into our app. In a production app, you probably want to keep these as a separate string resources, but for demonstration purposes, I'm just going to keep the hard-coded string here. Now let's take care of the nonce. Without going into too much detail about what a nonce is, it's essentially just a random piece of string that you can pass to a OAuth sign-in process to prevent replay attacks. Create a raw nonce variable up here. To get a random string, we're just going to use the uuid.getRandomID. Now we need to hash this raw nonce using SHA-256 hash function. To do that, first convert it to byte array. Then get a message digest instance with SHA-256 function. Then we create the digest of the array bytes of the raw nonce. And finally, we convert back the digest into a string representation of it to obtain the hashed version of the nonce. We pass the hash nonce to the setNonce function. We will also use the raw nonce value when we connect Supabase Auth later. Now let's create a coroutine scope up here for the API request we'll be making soon. Now let's create the request object down here. Call getCredentialRequest.builder.addCredentialOption, pass the Google ID option, and finally call build. And with this, we are ready to make the API call to complete the Google sign-in using Credential Manager. Create a coroutine with coroutinescope.launch. We can call credentialManager.getCredential to kick off the Google sign-in process. We will store the result in the result variable. We can then access the credential object. Now we can call Google ID token credential.createFrom and pass in the credential.data. And finally, we get access to the Google ID token by calling Google ID token credential.idToken. This ID token can be then used to connect it to other Auth providers using OpenID Connect, such as Supabase. We'll connect it to Supabase later, so for now, let's just log it to the console. Let's also display a message using toast so that we'll know the sign is complete. Let's also add some error handling. Wrap the code block with try catch brackets. We can catch the get credential exception. And for this example code, we're just gonna display a toast. Another exception to catch is Google ID token parsing exception. We should be able to run this app at this point. Let's update the default widget up here, create a column, and add the Google sign in button as its child. We can center the content both vertically and horizontally. Let's run the app. Let me close the bottom window here. And let's tap on that sign-in button. We have a beautiful bottom sheet popping up. Once the user verifies the Google account that they want to use for this sign-in, they can hit continue. And that's it! Users signed in using Google ID with Credential Manager. Now let's close the simulator and move on to adding Supabase authentication to this app. Let's add the Supabase Kotlin library to our app. Latest version as of recording this video is 2.1.3. Also, we don't need real-time, but we need GoTo, the Supabase's authentication library, so let's rename it. We also need the Kator client. Lastly, scroll up and let's add JSON serialization. My current Kotlin version is 1.9.10, but you might be using something else, so just enter whatever you're using. We also need to add internet access permission to use Supabase. Now that we've added all the dependencies, let's sync this project with Gradle files. To get started with Supabase, we first need a Supabase client. Call the createSupabaseClient method and install the Auth and Postgres libraries. We also need to obtain the Supabase credentials. Now I've gone ahead and created a Supabase project already for this video, but if you don't have one yet, you can head over to database.new to create one for free. Head to the settings or the gear icon and go to API. Here we can find the Supabase URL and the Supabase anonymous key. Now before we connect the Google login to our Supabase Auth, let's create a button that inserts data to our database. We can use this button to verify that our authentication is working properly. Create a coroutine scope variable, as well as a context variable. We can then launch a coroutine and call Supabase.from. We need to pass a table name to the from method, but we don't have one yet, so let's create one. Head back to the Supabase dashboard and open the table editor. Click new table, and give it a table name of posts. For the columns, let's add a content column. The data type should be text, and let's make it non-nullable. Let's also add a user ID column. This column would contain the Supabase Auth user ID of the person who posted the post. We can add a foreign key constraint to the auth.users table. Auth.users table is a table that's automatically created by Supabase, and it contains all the authenticated users data. We can give user ID a default value of auth.uid. Auth.uid function is a function created by Supabase, and it'll always contain the authenticated user's user ID. Let's also make this column non-nullable. Hit save to create the table. Great, we have a table now. We can insert it into our post table. We can insert a map of content to hello from Android. Fix this typo here. Let's also display a toast upon successfully inserting a data. Wrap the code with try catch block. Let's catch any exceptions thrown by Supabase. We can again display a toast when we receive an exception. Add this button to our UI, and let's run the app. Let me minimize this bottom window. And let's try to insert a data. And we get a message saying it violates the row-level security policy. This is expected because we haven't authenticated the user yet, and we also haven't created any policies, so Supabase just denies every single access by default. Let's connect Supabase Auth to the Google sign-in so that the users can make an authenticated request to our Supabase database. Call SupabaseAuth.signInWith and pass ID token. This method allows us to sign in to Supabase using the ID token we obtained from Google sign-in. Pass the Google ID token, provider set to Google, and we also pass the runons here. We also need to set up Google login on our Supabase dashboard. Go to Authentication, Provider, and Google. We need to provide the same client ID here. Copy the web client ID and paste it in. Then hit save. Great, let's also set some row-level security policies. If we go back to our posts table, we can see that we have no active row-level security policies. This means that all actions against this table would fail whether the user signed in or not. So let's create a policy that allows authenticated users to insert a row. Click New Policy, and let's go with the full customization option. Let's create an insert policy that allows authenticated users to insert a row. Select Authenticated as the target roles, and with checks should be auth.uid equals user ID. This policy allows authenticated users to be able to insert data as long as the user ID column matches their authenticated user ID. Great, the post table is ready to be tested. Let's refresh the app. First, try to insert. It fails as expected because we are not signed in. Let's perform Google sign-in now. Hit continue. And we should be now signed in with Supabase Auth. Try inserting again, and it succeeds. Head over to the Supabase dashboard to verify. And we can see the newly inserted data. And that's how you can get started with signing your users into your Android application with the new Credential Manager and connect it to Supabase Auth. If you want to see more Android and Supabase videos in the future, let us know what you want us to work on in the comments below. Also, remember to subscribe to our YouTube channel. I'll see you around. Bye.